Good evening and welcome to this edition of The Checkpoint. My name is Nicholas Wasaja. We hope out there you're wearing your mask. We hope you're sanitizing. We hope you're social distancing because COVID-19 is on an all-time rise and it does kill. So we need you alive. So you, if you're out to wear your mask, you need to social distance. And if you're in the category of Ugandans that are supposed to be taking their COVID jab, please do take it. Either it's the first shot or the second shot. Now, the nation is still in a frenzy over the appointment of a new cabinet with President Yoweri Kaguta Museveni at the helm. Yesterday, Parliament approved the names of the Right Honourable, Her Excellency, the Vice President, retired Major Jessica Alupo as Vice President of Uganda, and the Right Honourable Robina Nabanja as Prime Minister of Uganda. Parliament also yesterday varied the number of cabinet slots to 82 from 79 that we had in the previous term. Will this cabinet deliver is a question that we interrogate on the Checkpoint tonight with opposition stalwart and Butambala County MP, the Honourable Mwanga Chivumbi. Welcome to the show.
Welcome and dear viewers.
Honourable, to start our conversation, one of the things that for me was intriguing yesterday during your debate on appointment of the Vice President and the Prime Minister was your issue that you raised, that the appointments committee should be opened up to public scrutiny. One, what did you intend to achieve with this motion, and did you attain any success in that effort?
Well, the success we attained that now Ugandans are talking about it. That is in its way a first success. That's now a topical issue, and that Ugandans is now in the public domain, the pros and cons. But dark rooms in houses of representatives don't have a space in any modern democratic dispensation. We talk about openness, we talk about transparency, we talk about accountability. All the notions that define good governance means that you do everything that you do in the open. The appointments committee is not a security committee, is not a classified committee where it is its business can infringe and impair our security. No, these are public servants that are going to be concerned with the public delivery. There is need for the public to know the characters, the of course the qualifications. As long as you have senior six, you qualify to be a minister or a vice president. But there are accompanying things elsewhere in the world. If you are going to be a minister for finance or agriculture or mineral, you are required to have some level of expertise and knowledge in that field. And people look for people who are well-grounded and who have been in there. They can go down straight away on day one and start work. Ministry appointments are not a learning job. You must have accompanying character and qualities and a track record. These are things where even the public would be free to petition that a certain minister, someone going to become a minister, has an issue A, B, and C. And we are in the East African Protocol. We are part of African Union. We are a Commonwealth-leaning democracy, practicing Westminster democracy. Things that are done, actually, that appointments committee is more like a shrine. I mean, you are going to pronounce an appointment for approval of parliament in the name of my constituency. We have zero participation, zero information. Then you say, parliament has approved. In whose name? It is the people's representative forum. Yet you have a 30-man committee whose report will never be presented to plenary. Only some kind of announcement, and that is it. So, from the word go, it is scandalous. to have such a committee closed, and it's the only committee that is closed. The rest of other committee, including of defense and the budget, are all open.
Maybe for understanding purposes, in your view, why did the framers of the rules pertaining this particular committee think that it is important that vetting of the vice president and the prime minister should be done in the glare of the public, and while the other their juniors are vetted in an appointments committee that is closed?
Well, I'm not saying an appointments committee shouldn't be there.
Yes.
Because you are not going to have a plenary vetting all the 80 ministers, or 24, whatever case may be. No, you don't have that time. Two, when you are going to vet ministers, then you are looking for those specific capabilities and capacities to handle a particular task at hand. You can only interrogate that in a small meeting. But that process should be open. That's the case we are making.
I heard you say yesterday that at least to the media.
At least to the media. Mm. So that people know, in the minimum, if you are saying members cannot come, but at least in the minimum, the media should be there. I mean, what is it that you do? Present your CV, okay? If there are questions, your academic qualifications, answer. How are your qualifications related to the job? So, but it's kind of been building a kind of patronage and a kind of whatever power that people enjoy in that house. And it is high time that we beamed on it and said this kind of behavior does not have a space in a modern institution. And I only pray and hope that the new leadership of parliament find space for this discussion, and we completely and also do away with that kind of behavior. In any case,
your motion was shot down, and currently the appointments are going on, and the public is relying on the media to get them scant information.
Which media do you have? Only capture pictures.
Yes, pictures, exactly.
And as they walk out, even members there, they are on oath not to say anything.
Not to say anything. So if they are to say anything,
whose name are they working?
Exactly, Honorable. It seems it is a pertinent issue that the appointments committee should be open to the public. But then I would ask you: you had 5 years, and you had 5 years actually in the last lap of the 11th of the 10th Parliament. There was amendment of the rules of procedure, but this is not an issue that did come up. And actually, the Deputy Speaker was yesterday highlighting that probably this is a very pertinent issue that needs thorough debate. Why didn't this come
there
in the last 5 years?
There is no thorough debate in opening up a democratic space. It's just immoral what they are doing. And the very presence and persistence of that committee negates everything about good governance. There's no debate about it. Whoever wants it, wants monarchical powers, what's the secret for civil servants? And that should really open up. All appointments, even in districts, they should be open. So that is no longer done in the dark. If you apply for a job, you are shortlisted, you go for an interview, it is in public, you qualify or you fail, knowing so and so did well. But we've been hiding this, and this is very colonial. And it's not the first time that I've attempted to amend that.
That particular
yes.
clause.
The last time we amended these rules, I actually wanted to amend it. But you know, it encroaches on the very powers of the speaker. Okay? Because the speaker is the chairperson and the deputy of this committee. And speakers want to enjoy that unique kind of, it's the one committee where the speaker would privilege
that leaves the appointees at the mercy of
the speaker, and quite no speaker would want to do away with it, because it literally Shirai gives him that inherent power that is so powerful that you need to talk to him or at his own mercy. That appointments committee had reached a level of interpreting the constitution. You remember why we have generals?
Yes, serving officers
being contrary to the constitution. It is on the interpretation of that committee,
and I think it's still a subject of debate.
It is still court, it's still a court matter, but the interpretation was simply given in that committee, and in the plenary you can't discuss it. So really, that's why we have generals today not resigning and serving in a partisan government. Yet we are in a multi-party dispensation, and the doctrine is military and civil servants should not be partisan. Okay. It is the cutters. All these abuses have been coming by cutters of the secrecy of this committee, and it is high time we take it on and open it up. And I think for me, when I commit myself to struggle, this is an issue that we will knock out.
Honorable, that then begs the question, what are you going to be doing about it in 5 years?
Yeah, by the way, if you study how the ruler was using, remember earlier, the minister, Beta Mongin, was threatening to suspend rules of procedure. When there was the question of a CV and blah, 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 he said, but you can suspend. Now, the framers of that section 65, is it section 16 of our rules of procedure, were intended to abuse it. Because government is fond of every time come to parliament, wherever they are squeezed, they say, we suspend a rule. They never knew that the very, very section they are using, on a good day, I will apply it. And so it actually this evening empowers the speaker. Because so it says, a motion without notice. And they said, among the things that a member is permitted in our rules of procedures to move, is to move to suspend any rule of procedure. Apart from, there were those that were entrenched, and they are only concerned with the election of a speaker. But the rest of the rules, they are suspended by a mere motion. And can I tell you what? I wasn't doing a one-off. Day in, day out, they've been suspending these rules. So they have no moral justification whatsoever to continue to do what we are doing as a parliament. And I want to look in the face of any honorable member who wants to have a reason against it. I would want to meet one. I would die to meet one.
Honorable, moving on. It was also very intriguing that there is no debate held on the vetting of the vice president and the prime minister. Why was this so? And for me, the question is, don't you think parliament is kicking off at a very wrong foot?
The tone had been set by the debate that had ensued with the debate on the extension.
Yes.
And the kind of behavior tendencies that we saw, and kind of intolerance for debate. Secondly, increasingly, you come to a parliament when a matter has been decided by the caucus. Now, when it has been decided by a caucus and we are under COVID, you are going to constrain us for so many hours. You have crammed up 300 people for a debate that is largely academic, whose decision you have already taken. Therefore, it is only prudent for us who are not part of the caucus to say, don't expose us, don't waste our time. You've come here to say yes, okay, say it from the word go. No matter the merits of the debate, they will not change a thing about the outcome, because these decisions come when they are fully made up. So if I'm not going to add or subtract, so why do I engage? And at a risk, if there was no COVID and you want to have some good members go on the answered,
exactly, I was going to ask what happened to the notion of going.
Some members who want to go unanswered, but at the expense of my health, I will not entertain you. That's why I think the timing was bad, and it's me who moved and said, you don't waste our time.
Yes.
I know you've come here to say yes, say it. Because that's what they had come to say. They had demonstrated the same tendency with the motion on what? on expanding. So why on this one were you went to say this one speaks, Dokoro speaks? At the end of the day, they will say, aye. So say it from the beginning and you save our lives.
Well, don't you think that would be cheating out the people of Butambala who would want to hear your position on say, the quality of the vice president and the premier that have been appointed?
Now, it is value for money, value for time. What time? For what purpose? What will be the end purpose? To understand Nabanja better or Alupo better? And I assure you, even the speaker was saying, confine yourself to the he was even confining the discussion to basically what the law says. Wazimbile saying, if you have a question mark on the qualification, have rise up.
So that means from the word go, there was no room for debate.
There was no room for debate except for paying a tribute, if you want to say so. But I would appreciate if those were in the normal times and we are not under COVID. Maybe they could have space for that, and you can engage in an academic exercise. Maybe in the heat of a debate, you, the media, could pick a line, okay, that can make your evening. But at the expense of our health, I think that was uncalled for. And we believe, because what would you change? They had hammered a position. You remember, we tried. This is once beaten, twice shy. You know what happened in the election of the speaker and the deputy speaker. So the whole of this was a coronation. So why do you have to invite the whole village if you have already coronated your person?
Honorable, of course, for the second time in a space of 1 week, the president has changed his mindset, his mind twice. Initially, he said they were varying from 79 to 80 ministers, now 81 and now 82. My question would be, and interestingly, the opposition members that have increasingly been casting light on the nature of public expenditure are the ones that have been seconding these motions. Right from Kololo, we had Honorable Imat, and then yesterday we had Honorable Abdu Katuntu. One, I need to understand, do you think the justification given by Honorable Katuntu, your good friend and Imat, is sufficient enough for us to have a quote unquote a bloated government in the next 5 years?
I have had the privilege for 5 years to sit in the budget committee, and not as just an ordinary member, but with an eagle eye on the figures, and I know how difficult and how stressed our economy is, and how the component of governance and security is consuming a lion's share of our expenditure, and how all these governments we've created, the municipal councils, we equally don't have even money to fund them and to operationalize them. I've also had the benefit of being around to see the cabinet increase. Would have looked for better service delivery, better value for money, adequate and timely utilization of our borrowed money, and reduced levels of corruption. But to the contrary, the bigger the government, the higher. Can you believe how much money we spend on idle time? I don't know whether you understand idle time.
You could help.
No, idle time is where you have contracted, put a contractor, maybe to build a road or a school and whatever. And you said today start. And he puts his equipment there. And somehow along the way, for even the money you have already borrowed, things are not forthcoming.
I think the classic example is the new bridge, Kampala Express.
Yes. And the contractor, from day one, you say you have taken over this site, he begins to count, and you pay huge sums of money. At one time, UNRWA paid 300 billion in 1 quarter.
In 1 quarter, because they were paying 300 million daily for idle time.
In idle time. And how many ministers are in local government? You even had a whole authority called Uganda, is it what? National Roads Authority.
Yes.
With all that authority and so many ministers, we are losing 300 billion in one quarter on idle time with so many ministers, around three or four. Now, it goes across the budget. If reports are to be believed, every single day, 32 billion shillings get stolen. With all these 32 billion, for our viewers who don't know, to have a turnkey hospital, a turnkey complete hospital, you need 35 billion. To have a turnkey, start a hospital, open it when everything is there, you need 35 billion. So if they steal 32 per day, so every single day they steal a hospital, and you have all this big government. Even the president on this confesses, we're on the same page, that he has not been able to stop this corruption, irrespective of bigger.
So in your view, is it the numbers that are,
so that numbers don't count,
that are driving corruption?
No, numbers don't count. And the rationale they are giving is undermines even the national unity. You begin to say the people of Kasese, the people of this one, the people of this one, the people. Now, ministers are tribal representatives. You get now, the people of Iki don't have a minister, therefore you create a ministry.
Honorable Mwanga, don't you think that cabinet should be a reflection of what you can say?
For instance, I've been to Kasese. When you go to Kasese and you see, one, it is one region that has the highest number of people suffering from HIV. Okay? Poverty index in that area are so high. Do they need a minister with a flag, or they need a program to alleviate, to address their issues? Now, you mislead the people of Kasese to say, we've given you. For example, I come from Buganda. For quite some time, we've had prime ministers, we've had vice presidents. When I drive through Chanamukaka, where the former vice president comes from, is not any different from any other area without a prime minister. I come from Butambala, where we have the whole vice chairperson, national vice chairperson of NRM. Is it any different from the neighboring county because we have Haji Chigongo? So do the people of Butambala need better schools, better health facilities, better employment, or they need a big man with a big car, with escorts and a flag? So I think this, we've been taking the people for a ride.
Going on the real issues, one of the reasons, the justifications that was put was that there is an ongoing merging of agencies and government departments, and actually the number of permanent secretaries has been brought down to 21. Therefore, there is need for political supervision. Don't you think that's justification?
The new ministry they were creating was for information, I think, and gender.
Information, communication.
How has it got to do with the people of Kasese? Is there issue lack of a minister for information? Because they wanted to create a ministry for information, okay? And to be given to that Rwenzori Kasese was left out. How do you match the ministry with the needs of Kasese? Two ministers of state for information with the needs of Kasese. So it is simply a colonial mindset that for you to be seen, you are part of it, you must have your person there. If it is corruption, have a member on the table who represents you. If it is incompetence, as long as you have somebody who will come and say, no, please, I'm there. So it is kind of misleading, but be as it may, when you look at the NDP3, okay, which is like a cornerstone of our development, it talks about having a lean, efficient, and effective government and administration. It talks about wiping out agencies and merging them, eliminating wastage. So contrary from the first goal By setting up this government, you are walking away from the dictates of NDP 3. Mm-hmm. We still await for a chart of fiscal responsibility that will come across. I can tell you, a minister drives a car of 600 million on the market. Those Prado, the one they drive.
And the viewer is also asking that to construct a school, is also going to get 200 million.
To construct a school, like for argument's sake,
yes.
To construct two buildings of a primary school, you need 50 million. Complete. Yes. Mm. For children to go in and study. So that means every minister sits in 12 classrooms to go and supervise children seated in trees.
And for fairness's sake, every MP also has schools
Even MPs have four schools.
Yes.
They are going to write to die. I'm not making a case that MPs
should be left off the hook.
No. So that's why we are saying, do you need some 500 fellows whom if you have nowhere to sit them up?
But Honorable, that goes to the debate that was had in, I think it was 2019, either 2019 or early 2020, when the number of constituencies was increased. You now have a parliament of 529 MPs.
No.
And that is number where the of challenge constituencies have actually the political will. To be able to address a lean government began in parliament where they are the people's representatives.
No, actually, the way that parliament is constructed is kind of also a bit archaic. When they were carving out,
yes.
They were supposed to be on a basis of demography, population ratio. They put a population ratio and said for every, by then, 70,000 people. 70,000. Is that 70,000?
70,000.
There should be one representative.
One representative.
Then the argument came that how about areas that are so large and they have sparse populations? They said, okay, for affirmative action, okay, let every county also, even if it doesn't have the population ratio also become a constituency, and they said that counties should be decided by parliament, okay, but constituencies should be created by the electoral commission at every end. What actually the law says, every 12 months after the population census are announced, the electoral commission should come up with a new population ratio and a new mapping, okay, of new constituencies. We've not had, for the last 20 or 30 years, the Electoral Commission come up to demarcate constituencies based on population ratio. What do we get? We get counties created, okay? Counties created. Because counties are created in terms of gerrymandering. Where you feel that, you want to balance up numbers, you go to a smaller area and you create a constituency. That's why you have a speaker, he normally takes offense. When he was the speaker, he said, I will not pass this bill until mine is also divided. That's why Rafael Magez also said, this one, mine will also be divided. So that's how you now have that parliament of 500 disproportionately representing smaller numbers, yet areas that have huge population because of political reasons are left without demand because the Electoral Commission did not do its work. So that big parliament is in itself, and it has aims. First of all, it was always, government runs an effective spy machinery. It can predict the voting trends ahead of an election. So they normally create sub-county to balance the losses so that they maintain with the two-thirds majority that can always be used to tinker with the constitution. As simple as that.
Does that explain why in Busiro East you have one MP representing nearly half a million people?
Yes.
Honorable,
yet the people of Iki There are only 1,000 voters.
Honorable, we are going to go for a very short break.
So, but all of them come up and parade. We are also representatives. And we are speaking with equal basis. So that explains that a lot of all these things that are driving public expenditures, okay, can be rationalized and find a reasonable balance.
With that, Honorable, let's go for a very short break.